My query's running too slow. Again, I need to make it faster. But how? The great power of SQL is its declarative nature. You tell the database the result you want, and it figures out the best way to get it. So if the database decides how to execute your query, how do you go about making it faster? Well, you need to look at how the database accesses your tables and join them. With this information, you can then see if there's a better route available. To do this, you need to get its execution plan. But what is this execution plan? How do you get one? And how does it help you make your SQL faster? Let's get the plan. When you send a query to the database, it's the job of the SQL optimizer to figure out how to execute it. This results in the query's execution plan. This is the driving directions for your query. But instead of telling you which roads to take and when to turn, it lists how to access your tables and in which order. For example, join table 1 to table 2, then join in table 3. By looking at the routes the database took, you can see if there's a faster path available, or if you can create new access methods to make a shortcut. So, how do we get this plan? Before we answer that, be aware that there are two types of plan available: explain and execution. An explain plan doesn't run the query, so this is just a prediction about what might happen when you really do. This prediction can be wrong for a whole host of reasons. So when performance tuning, it's the execution plan that you need. There are various techniques to do this in Oracle Database, including the SQL Monitor, DBMS X-Plan, tracing the query, and various third-party tools. But in these videos, I'll focus on using the auto-trace option in Oracle SQL Developer. To use it, select your query and hit this button. The query will run, and you'll soon be greeted with a plan like this. Okay, so how the heck do you follow these directions? Where do you even start? Firstly, the plan is a tree. Data flows up it, from the leaves to the root. The tables are the leaves, the select statement at the top, the root. In between are a whole host of possible operations. Each of these receives rows from its children and passes them up to its parent. These fall broadly into three categories: single child, multi-child, and joins. Single child operations have exactly one operation below them. Sorting, grouping, and aggregating are good examples of these. If your query includes a group or order by, you'll have one of these in your plan. Multi-child operations have one or more data sources below them. These are relatively rare. You're most likely to bump into these when unioning tables together. When you do this, the database combines the rows from each table into a single union operation in the plan. So that just leaves joins. We'll cover the exact details of how these work in a future episode. For now, all you need to know is that every join is the proud parent of exactly two children, each of which may themselves be joins, tables, or any other plan operation. In theory, the database can join tables in any order. Say I have 4 tables: colors, bricks, pens, and cuddly toys, and I want to join them all on color. The database could start by joining colors to bricks, and separately join pens to cuddly toys, then combine the result of these two intermediate steps into the final dataset. So the last join combines the output of joins. But this is rare in Oracle Database. Left to its own devices, the optimizer will usually have at least one child of a join be a table or other single child operation. So when combining these 4 tables, it'll pick 2 tables to start with, then add in the rows from the 3rd before finally linking the 4th table's data to give the final query output. Because we're building up the result set as we go along, it's best to start with the 2 tables that return the fewest rows. This minimizes how much data you're carrying around and the work to join each new table in. So I start by joining the colors to the cuddly toys, then add in the bricks, finishing with the table that returns the most rows, the pens. Okay, so how do you know which table the optimizer started with? and whether this is the one that returns the fewest rows. Well, the first table accessed is the one that's top in the plan. To find this, travel along the plan and down until you find a step with no child. This table passes its rows up to the join above, which then requests values from its other child to add to the intermediate result set. This process continues back up the tree. At each point, you're adding rows to the intermediate results from another table, until finally you get to the last join, which passes the data to the select and onto the client. So in this plan, the database started with the colors, joined those rows to the cuddly toys, added in the pens, before finally joining in rows from bricks. Okay, so we've figured out the order of processing, but what about how many rows we're getting? Find that by going to the preferences, searching for autotrace, then selecting the last output rows and last starts columns. While you're here, make sure you check fetch all rows to ensure it gets all the data. Do that, run autotrace, and you can see how many rows flowed out of each step in the plan. So in this plan, you can see that we have 3 rows coming out of colors, which are joined to 5 rows from cuddly toys, resulting in 3 rows. We then add in 9 rows from the pens, which gives a total of 7, and including the 24 rows from the bricks table, which gives a total output of 56 rows. Easy, right? Well, maybe. There are plenty of exceptions when it comes to reading execution plans, which don't exactly follow these rules. For example, I said that the topmost table in the plan is the one accessed first, except when it isn't. Why would this happen? Scalar subqueries. If you have a select buried in the select of your query, the database gets all the rows from the main query first, then passes the values to the subquery, so it runs this part last. But in the plan, these scalar subqueries appear at the top. So, even though the plan lists bricks first, it accesses this table last. It starts with the colors table, then runs the subquery once for each value this returns. You can verify this by looking at the last starts column. This is 3 for bricks, which matches the number of rows fetched from colors. So, by viewing the plan, you can follow the driving directions for your SQL. The starting point is normally the topmost operation with no children. The database then works down the plan, going to the next sibling of this table, and repeats the process, searching down for the next leaf. Okay, so what? How does having this plan help you make your SQL faster? Well, to figure that out, there's 2 questions you need to answer. Is this the best order to join the tables? And is there anything you can do to reduce the work the query does? We'll get into details for the second question in future episodes. For now, let's focus on the join order. How do you know if this is right? Well, remember, the optimizer refers to start with the 2 tables that return the fewest rows and finish with the one that returns the most. But how does it know this? Clearly, querying each table to see how many rows it returns isn't going to work if the tables are huge. So it estimates. If these guesses are accurate, it's likely that the database has found the best plan available. So what does it base these estimates on? And what can you do about it if they're wrong? Well, this uses the table statistics, summary information about the data stored in each. We'll get into details of these in the next episode. Thanks for watching. Got any execution plans you're struggling to understand? Post them in the comments and we'll see how we can help. And subscribe for more SQL tips.